So, welcome to my talk. This will be quite a high-paced, high-speed talk because I have only 20 minutes and there's a lot to cover. And on the program, I've put in beginner. So there was a definition on what beginner and intermediate would be. So I put in beginner because you don't need to know that much upfront. But in the end, you will be an indexing expert. All right. So really quick about me. I'm home in the geo world. I do a lot of geo databases and geo stuff. So you might have heard of GeoCouch before. That is one of my previous projects. And I did implement geo indexes for CouchDB, as I said, GeoCouch for Couchbase and RocksDB. And yes, I mostly code in JavaScript these days, but I love coding in Rust, Python, and Erlang. And I love open source. So what is noise? Noise is all about JSON. So you input JSON and you get JSON out. And it's an embedded search index engine, So the important part is it's similar to Lucene. So we are not talking about like the level of Elasticsearch or Solr, but really on the Lucene level. It's an embedded thing. And it can do full text search, ranges, and geo. And I would even pretend it does geo properly, because it's not just like a geo hash or space filling curve, but it's a proper R tree implementation. And the next thing is, whenever I talk to people about like databases, or a new database comes out, a new NoSQL database comes out, they always have their own query language. And I always tell people, please stop creating new query languages, because we have already plenty of them. They're incompatible. So I spent like a month or so in research on which query language I should use. And the result was obviously that I introduce a new one. But it is based on a concept called query by example. Probably not many of you have heard of it before. It's from the 70s, and obviously it lost the war against SQL. But I still think it's a great idea. So it's based on this concept. And to understand it a bit better, I start with a demo. As I said, I have only 20 minutes, so this demo will be pretty quick. If we have time afterwards, for some reason, I can show you more stuff. So how does it look like? So we want to find things, and we just want to find everything in the database. Now you wonder, those weird IDs things, by default, I just return the IDs, because you don't want to return like your full database on a simple query. Of course, you might also want to have only a subset. So we can just limit it to one. This is for the next steps to make it easier. So one ID, OK, this works. And now we want to see what's actually in this database, in this index. It's not a database, it's an index. So this means I return the whole document. And what we see here is, let's see, it's JSON, as I said, so you input JSON. And it has some geometry. So it's a geo demo, because, as I said, I come from the geo world. And at the bottom, you see some more interesting stuff. So this data set is actually about weather warnings. In Germany, it's from the last year. So it's from July. And yeah, you can see stuff like, what is the risks? There will be hail, there will be wind, and all those things. But now, that's of course, like, you don't always want to return the full data set. You want to filter on things. How does the filtering work? And now we have a good example of like what means query by example. So I want to query on everything where the altitude is bigger than zero. So what I do is I just copy it, because you use the result basically as example. So this would be proper JSON. The query language is not proper JSON, because what we do now is we want to get everything that is bigger than zero. So what we do is we just say bigger than zero. And we do the query. I also remove the limit one, because like it has, so you can see it can return more than one result. And now we see here we have plenty of different documents. Let me scroll to one. Yeah. So there starts a new one, and all have the altitude which is bigger than this. Now, of course, what you also can do is you want to return only a subset. So we want to know like which events are on a high altitude. So for example, we just return the description. So this is kind of like path notation. So we say description. Description, right? And so you see, those are winds somewhere in the mountains. And again, you can already guess it from the background. You can, of course, return more complex stuff. And from the background, you can see I want to show some geodata. So I can just return any JSON I want. And I've coded this UI, so if I return the geometry, which is stored in info area geometry, then it should return where it actually is. Area, okay. I'm not good with typing today. So we see them, so there's here someone, so this event is no longer a threat, and we see some in the Alps. All right, that's, oh, and another thing, of course, you can also like the return value, so I just display the return value, which is a description, but of course, if it is like a deeply nested JSON thing, I will quickly show it. It will also, of course, return the JSON, so you can see here now it's like nested. That's a JSON. All right, that's enough for the demo, because as I said, I want to explain like how does all this work. First of all, what you've seen is you haven't seen the insertion process, but well, that's just putting JSON in. And the thing compared to other full text indexes is it does the indexing automatically. So you might have heard of CosmoDB from Microsoft, previously called DocumentDB. They do a similar thing. And also their paper is pretty much what we do. The idea that we use for this project is not new. It's from 10 years ago. It was a prototype project at IBM. You can read more about it on the Apache CouchDB Jira issue 52 or 56. So it's really in the early days. It never took off. And this is where the ability comes from. And if you read the paper from Microsoft, it really is similar. So I would suspect that someone from the authors was involved with this part, perhaps. All right. So we do indexing automatically. So strings will become available for the full text search. Numbers, you can do queries on ranges. And GeoJSON will result in bounding boxes that you can do geo queries on it. So I haven't really shown it, but you can really search in bounding boxes. And as you've seen from the query language, you just put in the JSON from the result, basically. You put an operator in front of what you want to query on, and that's it. All right. I said fast pace because I need to speed up. The technologies used, currently we have a Node.js API for the database, for the index. And there's a Python prototype I did just like in one day at a code sprint. And the whole thing is coded in Rust, as the title suggested. For those who don't know Rust, it's a fast, safe, and better C++. Many languages say so, but if you look into Rust, it's really true. And the underlying thing, we use RocksDB. It's a solid key value store from Facebook. And now, how is it different from other databases? I touched it already a bit, the automatic indexing. But so this is probably the most controversial slide in my slide deck. But the general idea is, in a traditional full-text system, you normally flatten the data with some mapping. So although you input JSON, you need some mapping into some flat structure. Or there's also document databases, which have some SQL dialect, where they then can query on JSON. But then you kind of flatten the data on query time into a table structure, because SQL is really meant for tabular data. And noise is different, because it preserves the structure when it's inserted, and also when it's queried. All right, so now how does it work? That's the exciting part. The important thing is, the key part is the shredder. So every JSON gets shredded into key value pairs. For most of this, obviously for the whole presentation, we don't really care about the key. I talk about the value only. We don't care about the value. I talk only about the key. So what does it mean? So we have an event called heat, and then it gets shredded into this simple key below. So the nested structure becomes like the dot notation. And then in the end, the value of the input becomes part of the key. So in this part, example, it's a full text index. So there's an exclamation mark in between. And the important part in the end, that's really the important part for the next few slides, is we assign to every document you insert, it becomes an internal ID. It's like a monotonic increasing number. And the key part of like how this all the indexes work, why this is fast, is that everything is sorted kind of by this ID. All right, even the geoindex. So a few examples to get a feeling of how it works. So in the first two lines, we see we have something which is nested. It's info and then category. And we have there the word met. And at the end, we see it has two different internal IDs. So which means it's in there are two different documents in this index which have the same structure and have the word met in the category. The other ones, for example, there's a description, and it says high and risk. So it's the same document because it has the same internal ID. And so the description contains several words. So we really split every single word into its own key. And the last example is just, of course, it can be nested more deeply. So it could be even info, parameter, and then thunderstorm, for example. All right. So this is about the shredding. So this is how it gets basically indexed into the index. The querying works similar to the digital database, the Volcano iterator model for all the database geeks in the audience. So we pass the query, we'll build up a query engine, and then we iterate through the conditions we have. An example will make it clearer. So our example query, I normally show in the demo, but I haven't had the time. So it has two conditions. So first, we query on the description should contain the word high. And this is a geoquery, so we query on the area. So I start here. So the description is high. So what we do, the same thing as with the indexing, we shred the query, basically. And we say, OK, this is our full text operator. So we query it like a full text index. So it becomes, so if you've thought about it, so we nest the stuff, so it basically becomes like this key. And you probably have an idea how then things work internally. You do the same with the geometry. So the end-end is the bounding box operator. And you query on this area, but the area doesn't really matter. The details we'll see in the query. So now, we have those two conditions. And we want to have all documents which match those two conditions. So we start. The query engine has passed everything, so now we build everything up. So we start with the first condition. We look for, in the index, is there anything that matches info description, exclamation mark, high? And you can imagine it's like a table scan. Of course, it's optimized, but think about it, scans the whole index, and you can easily find the ones where it matches the word high. Then it goes, it has the first match, and we remember the internal ID at the end of this key. And we save it, because this is a potential candidate. Like this document matches this condition. Now we move on to the next condition, which is the geometry query. And the geometry query works similarly. So I could give a full talk about how this indexing works. But in the end, it's again like a sorted list of internal IDs, which are within the bounding box I query on. So now I look into it, and I start at the top and scan through it and need to find one which is bigger than 244, because I already know no other document matches. So now I find the next biggest one, and in this case, it's 333. So now those two IDs don't match. So there is no document currently that matches both conditions. So now I came back to the previous condition and move on with an iterator kind of system to the next match. Oh, and we see this one looks good. It actually matches the internal ID. So it means we have one document which matches both conditions. So now we have a result. We are happy, and we return the result. So now we go on with the next match. There might be more documents matching it. And we have the 720, so we now go back to the other condition, so we know how this game works now. We scan through it from the 333, going forward, and we see there's no match anymore. So no other document could possibly match. So we are done, we have a single result. And this leads to the cool thing about this index is if you have several conditions, if there's one condition which really narrows down the result, the query should be fast because you can easily then skip over all the other conditions. And that's actually a property which is often the case, especially with geodata. Because what often happens is you either query like a huge area and a small time slice or the other way around. So for example, you query for the average temperature of several countries, like a huge extent, but you only want to know it from the past week. Or you want to have like a time series of a city with the pollution, some pollution values over the past year, but it's a small area in a long time frame. And as I said, as one condition is small, you can skip over a lot of data, so the query should be fast. The future plan is, so it's an open, I always forget to mention that it's an open source project because like everything I do is open source, so therefore I always forget it. So it's an open source project, it's on GitHub from the beginning on. And so I plan to do basically mostly what people need. So of course I have my own ideas, which you can see below, but most important is like, because if no one's using it, there's no point of developing it. And if there's something missing, yeah, I will edit. So one thing is, as I said, it does the automatic indexing of everything. Sometimes you want to exclude things because like you have some, let's see, even some binary data in your JSON somehow. You want not index it as with a full text index, so you just exclude it. Then support for more programming languages. As I said, there's currently only a Node API and a Python API was just like, it's not even published. So I want to support more languages, perhaps even like have a Java binding, so for all those Java folks. And another thing is the question is if it should be scaled up or down. So should it become like a full-blown distributed system like Elasticsearch? It's certainly from the technical perspective, from the architecture, it's possible. Or should it be scaled down? But I don't mean scaling down to microcontrollers, but really like to single machines. So you are out in the field, you have your, you fly with a drone and you want to do a quick analysis on your flight, on the data you have, like was it a good flight or not? You don't want to like spin up your full Elasticsearch cluster, but just have a quick analysis of your data. Or even for like basic data analysis, so you download your open data, want to have a quick look like what's in there, because you don't need a schema, you can just look into it, dig into it. So for such cases, it could be used. And finally, it might have a future in the interplanetary file system. You might have heard of it's a distributed file system for the distributed web. And there, at one point, you want to have search, obviously, and not only hashes. So it might live on there. So that's all from my side. Thanks for the attention.
Anyone has a question? No? If not?
So are there no questions? So you can, like, we have still 1 minute, so.